All right, folks, we are headed back 30 years to 1993. So let's just kind of place ourselves, shall we, in this 30-year-ago world. The Pentium microprocessor was introduced in 1993. I have nothing more to say about that.
I mean, it kind of launched the way for Intel. And I mean, we went to Pentium, Pentium 2, and all of a sudden they got hit by AMD and had some actual competition. We've had a competition race between the two of those for, I don't know, since then, really. So,
and this is why we have
big introduction. Okay. Yeah.
The arms race, the microprocessor wars.
This is the other thing, is that Islamic fundamentalists bombed the World Trade Center the first time.
Yeesh.
Right? So, of course, you know, 9/11 is seared into our memories. But it actually happened before that. In 1993, there was a terrorist attack on the World Trade Center. Also in 93, the Beanie Baby was introduced onto the world.
I had several Beanie Babies. I had a flamingo. I wish I had bought the Princess Di one, because now that's worth like millions of dollars. But
oh, wow. There's a Princess Di Beanie Baby?
Yeah.
Huh.
Yeah, look it up. It's worth like a crazy amount of money. I don't know why I know this, but there you go.
I weep for humanity. And then federal agents raided the Branch Davidian complex in Waco, Texas, and that was all over the news for months.
I remember that big time.
So I went last year when I was in Waco. I went to the complex, which is open, and you can go to it. And like, I'm not really a person who, you know, is like, I feel the vibes. You know, that's not my thing. I felt the fucking vibes when I was up at the Branch Davidian. It was the creepiest place I have ever been.
Okay.
Wow.
It was like you roll right in and you feel it. And of course they had like Trump flags everywhere, which like only heightened the creepiness of, you know, being in 2022. Yeah. It was the legit, the creepiest place I've ever been. I couldn't get out of there fast enough. Like, I think I burned rubber getting the fuck out of there.
Okay. Well, you know what? Follow and subscribe for more Waco tourism tips. Top of the Pops in 1993, I Will Always Love You, written, of course, by Dolly Parton, covered by Whitney Houston. It was everywhere. Couldn't get away from it.
Still can. But
beautiful.
I mean, great song, but it's still around.
Completely overplayed, but you have to just acknowledge its genius. I mean,
look, the Bodyguard soundtrack is a really fucking good soundtrack. I've actually never seen the movie, but it was one of those like buy the soundtracks before you see the movie, and I have listened to every song a million times. It's a great soundtrack, so FYI.
Good to know.
Yeah.
The Best Picture Oscar, of course, awarded in 1994, was for Spielberg's other big movie of 93, Schindler's List. Which, as I recall, was my pick for what we... So you could have just spent the last week watching a three-hour opus about the Holocaust, but Matt saved you from that.
You were making out during Schindler's List.
And finally, the biggest movie at the box office in 1993 is the one we are about to discuss. Jurassic Park pulled in $914 million. At the box office.
Is that in $93 or 2020?
That's in $93.
I'm
almost a billion.
I'm converting that right now.
So it held that title too until Titanic. It was the largest grossing movie.
Ever.
Yep, ever.
And Titanic was pretty much right around the corner because...
Yeah, I mean, we've already done it, so...
Yeah, 4 years. there you go. That's 1993, folks. Good times. Clinton was in the White House.
I was in high school.
Didn't know what we had. Didn't know what we had.
Welcome to the Rewind Project, where Allie, Matt, and Eric take another look at your favorite milestone movies through the lens of our present day. Will it be a skip, rent, or buy? Stay tuned and find out.
Well, welcome back, everybody, to the Rewind Project. I'm Matt.
I'm Eric.
I'm Allie.
Today, we're going to be talking about one of my favorite movies of all time, 1993 classic Jurassic Park, written by Michael Crichton and David Keop, Cope?
David Cope? There's a lot of extra vowels in that name.
Based on a novel by Michael Crichton and then directed by Steven Spielberg.
This is probably going to get rid of every bit of cred I've had on this podcast, which is probably not much to begin with. I totally forgot this was directed by Steven Spielberg.
Oh, what? Wow.
I know.
I think about when I think about this movie is the close-up on the glass of water.
So good.
Yes. Trembles. And that's just vintage Spielberg. I mean, nobody sets up a shot the way he does. Nobody can hint at thing. I mean, it's just, you know, who would have thought, let's get everyone to realize just how heavy a T-Rex's foot is by doing a close-up on a glass of water in the Jeep. But it's so effective because you just see that. And the way that it's, you know, completely still for 2 seconds before and 2 seconds after. And it's so creepy. That and the eye.
In
the window of the Jeep, because the head is so big that, you know, only the eye can kind of sneak in there. I mean, yeah, nobody does that shit as well as Spielberg does.
So supposedly that water scene came to Spielberg when he was driving in his car listening to Earth, Wind and Fire. And the bass line was doing that inside his car. And so if he thought about that, would be a really great thing to do inside the movie. So they had to come up with it. They used a guitar string inside the deck of the, or the dashboard of the car to recreate the sounds that would actually do that in the water.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah.
Brilliant.
Yeah, brilliant.
I mean, it just, you know, totally got you in there. And yeah, you know, Spielberg, what a year, too. I mean, between this and Schindler's List in the same year.
Well, and he got to do this movie. He got to do Schindler's List because he did this movie. That was the boss of Universal's parent company said, I'll let you do Schindler's List if you do this movie. So, and he did them. He filmed this one. And then while he was editing this one remotely, while they were doing the special effects and stuff, he was actually filming Schindler's List. So he was kind of like bipolar on it.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So this movie did have some notable achievements. Oscar winner, best sound effects editing, and best visual effects. All well deserved.
All track.
Still looks great today.
I was just about to say that. Like, even now, watching it literally yesterday, I was like, these dinosaurs look really pretty fucking good for 30 years ago.
They do. And one of the first implementations of computer graphics like that. So, I mean, they were not originally, we'll talk about that later, originally supposed to be computer graphics. Best Grammy for Best Instrumental Composition Written by a Motion Picture or for Television. So shout out to John Williams. This is an amazing score. I love this.
Him I recognized right away. I was like, oh, that's John Williams.
That's
I don't know what that says about me. Is this still a category for the Grammys? I wonder.
I don't know. People's Choice Award, I'm going to throw it out there. Favorite Motion Picture of the Year. There were a lot of other awards too, but it's mostly science fiction kind of
awards. Sure. And stuff. That's funny. Yeah. People's Choice Awards. People loved it. People loved it.
Bad choices, though. I never go to the People's Choice Awards. It's like, you know, if I ever got a People's Choice Award, I'd be embarrassed.
I don't know. This is the one time I'll agree with the People's.
The People's.
In 2018, it was selected by the Library of Congress for preservation in the United States National Film Registry as being culturally, historically, aesthetically significant, and all around fucking awesome. So, yeah.
No lies.
Did you say that?
I added that.
I thought so.
So the plot of this film, a kindly, well-intentioned billionaire builds a theme park of live dinosaurs, only to be undone by a greedy hacker who allows the dinosaurs to escape and prove you can't truly control wild animals or Mother Nature.
I don't think he was kindly or well-intentioned.
I think he thinks he was. Most billionaires think that they're kindly and well-intentioned. Mm.
I think he's a real dick, but we'll get to that.
Awesome. Self-identified kindly and well-intentioned billionaire I can handle, because he did think that he was like a great dude. But yeah, he was an egomaniac and as Ali said, kind of a dick.
So let's get into it and start off the cast. Richard Attenborough, second time we're going to talk about him this season. He plays John Hammond, the previously mentioned billionaire.
Look, he probably had so much fun on that movie. He must have been so full from chewing all that scenery. I don't know.
Well, this is his first appearance in film in 13 years. So this is the first time he'd been in a movie again in 13 years.
I mean, what a movie though, right?
Yeah. Big way to come back. So,
I mean, I have very little to say about John Hammond or Richard Attenborough. I mean, it was a fine performance, and you need this character obviously to get the whole thing going, because someone's got to be Looney Tunes enough to say, hey, let's bring back dinosaurs. That'll be fun. And while we're at it, let's start with a T-Rex and a velociraptor, because that sounds safe. I mean, you know, what an idiot.
I mean, you know, that doesn't track. Why would you danger species? Why would you do that? Why wouldn't you just do the herbivores first, test out your park, and then maybe come out with a better way to do things?
Because T-Rexes will make all the money.
I was going to say, You know, that shit sells. You know, if I'm going to Jurassic Park, which I wish I could, I would want to see the T-Rex and the Velociraptor. Like, I'll go there first.
True. Very true. Because you want to ride, when you go to an amusement park, you always ride the coasters first, and then whatever's left over, you ride.
Right. And then you're going to the log flume, then you're going to see the brontosaurus. Right?
So I will say I really did enjoy Richard Attenborough. This is probably because it had been his first role in 13 years. This was my introduction to him, you know, before I saw him in Elizabeth. He's just one of those people that is very charismatic on screen. So you enjoy him, even if he is playing a billionaire douche that is not really doing the world any service by bringing back dinosaurs, because that's not really a smart thing to do.
I really liked his monologue about the flea circus when he's sitting there with Laura Dern and kind of having that conversation. But then he just turns around and goes, next time we'll do this. And it's like, dude, your grandchildren are probably going to die.
I wish.
What the fuck are you talking about? I mean, that was when I was just like, okay, this guy, like, John Hammond needs to die.
But to your point, I mean, that's the egomaniac in him. It was, you know, that's the point when you do realize that he's not well-intentioned. He just thinks because he has enough money and he has enough power to actually control anything. There is a way to control everything. And there's just not. I mean, everything can't be controlled.
Life finds a way, Matt.
Life. Yes. I'd smack the table now just like Ian Malcolm.
Never trust somebody with two first names. You know, like first and last name. I never trust somebody who has like two first names as their full name. Just as a good general rule. Applies to this movie too. Yeah.
Next up, we have Sam Neill as Dr. Alan Grant.
I love Sam Neill, but like he can never mask his Australian accent.
Okay, so I'm going to say I didn't realize he was actually Australian. So.
I love Sam Neill. It was good to see him not play an asshole. For some reason, there's something about, you know, he's a good looking guy, but there's something about his face that makes him very appealing to casting directors when they're casting the, like, usually the jerk husband. And so it was nice to see him play somebody kind of decent. And, you know, all I have to say about Dr. Alan Grant is that being childless is a valid choice and you should stick with it.
I don't disagree.
I mean, I guess I'm the only one that really picked up on this, but like the whole time I'm watching this movie, I'm like, this is like parenthood propaganda. Like he starts the movie by saying, you know, Laura Dern, who we're about to talk about, love her, goddess, but we'll get there. She wants kids. Valid choice. Like, I'm not anti-parenthood at all. She wants children. He does not. And as the movie goes on, it was like these little kids end up in Sam Neill's Jeep. And it's like, well, she told us to sit here because it would be good for you. And I'm like, all right, Laura Dern. And then, you know, he saves them from the dinosaurs. And by the time the movie is over, they look like mom and dad and their two little blonde children. And as they're flying away in a helicopter, they're resting their heads on his shoulder. And she's got this real self-satisfied smirk going, aha, I got you. You will now propagate with me. And I was like, he didn't want kids. And that's okay. Like, you know, and it is your first reaction to saving people and almost being eaten by dinosaurs being like, I want to be a dad. I mean, what does that have to do with anything? Like, stop it.
Well, okay. As a woman who chose to be who's child free by choice, I think also I don't disagree with you, but also I think that's the difference between a little bit of 1993 and 2023. Wow. Wow, 30 years. That's what we're talking about. But like, for instance, you know, even 5 years ago, if I had said, you know, if somebody asked me if I had children, I'd be like, nope, nope, thank goodness. Like, or, you know, something, you know, I would sometimes get a look or, but, you know, when I meet people today and I tell them that, they're like, good for you for knowing what you want. Good for you for not bringing children into this world if you're not interested in them. So I think some of that, you know, from a woman's perspective, has shit, not enough. I think there's still a lot of, you know, anti- child-free people out there. But I think that the perspective has shifted too. So like, not all on Laura Dern, maybe that's just what she thought because that's what society told her in 1983 is what she had to do.
Oh, sure. No, this is totally a, you know, just a comment on, wow, this is a way that the world has changed in 30 years.
Yeah, for sure.
Watching this particular 30-year-old movie, I was like, you know what, Sam Neill, your life is not meaningless. You are one of the world's leading experts in dinosaurs. You've left your mark. You don't have to propagate in order to have a legacy.
Right.
You're okay. But the movie wants you to think, oh, now his life will be complete now. Blah.
Bark. I did not get any of that. I mean, I don't think there's any propaganda going on that if you don't have children, your life is incomplete. I think that's a major overstatement. I think she was pushing to see, is he going to like want kids or not? I mean, she wants to know, because if this is going to be a relationship, which the movie was trying to push them together, and she does want kids, that's a major conversation that people are going to have and something they have to deal with.
That's a conversation they need to have. But I will plant my flag here. The movie says that Sam Neill was wrong.
We were going to agree to disagree. I don't think he was saying that.
And I just don't
Spielberg is definitely a family man. And I think he does put family ideas inside a lot of his movies. And again, there was cute interactions between Sam Neill and the kids. So during the time, I don't want to say grows as a person. He just learns that he maybe doesn't dislike children as much as he did previously, and he can accept them. Doesn't mean that they're going to go off and procreate, because they still do the digs and stuff. And I don't know that raising kids out in the middle of Death Valley, wherever they were in the beginning of the film, is actually that great of an idea anyways. I don't know if they...
Oh, they're going to do it. They're going to end now.
I've seen Jurassic Park 2 and 3, so that actually... No, spoiler alert. Okay, well, since we've already started talking about her... Actually, and I will say I did love Sam Neill in this movie. This is also my introduction to him, too. And why I was so disappointed when we got to see Event Horizon, because trash film. Next up is Laura Dern as Dr. Ellie Statler. It's strong heroine in this movie, I felt like, even though she's pushing this guy to have kids. So I really did love Laura Dern.
Go sit in his Jeep. It'll be good for him. I love Laura Dern. She's amazing. I was introduced to Laura Dern in David Lynch's Wild at Heart, which is, that is a wild ride.
That is a wild ride.
Yes, that's some crazy shit. So, you know, right away I was like, okay, Laura Dern is kind of out there. But in the 30 years since, even Marmee in Little Women, she was kind of badass, you know, and Big Little Lies and all this stuff she's still doing. She's amazing. Citizen Ruth, amazing. Yeah, I love her.
I thought she was fine. I didn't really feel one way or the other about Laura Dern. I was kind of agnostic about Laura Dern in this movie. I did like that there was a smart female, she's a little bit better drawn in the book, but I like when she was like, these plants are fucking poisonous. Like, what are you doing? Like, I'm sure that they look good. And I was like, yeah, you go, Laura Dern.
And she's not afraid to get her hands dirty. Like,
no.
Like,
oh, I forgot about that scene.
You're going to wash your hands afterwards, aren't you?
So nasty.
I'm not responding so much to Ellie Statler as I am to just the 30 years that Laura Dern has had after this movie. It was just nice to see her. I just like her a lot.
Well, and she was the first choice for the role. There were other people were offered, but she was Steven Spielberg's first choice.
I mean, genius recognizes genius, right? Greatness recognizes greatness. So,
next up, we've got Jeff Goldblum. Oh.
He's so hot in this movie. I'm sorry. I know he's so quirky and weird, but I don't know. And I have always thought Jeff Goldblum was hot. I actually think he's more attractive now, 30 years later, as Zaddy. But he, in this movie, and when I was rereading the book, all I could see was him. All the other characters didn't, you know, I didn't stand out. But when I was reading Ian Malcolm in the book, I was like, Jeff Goldblum fucking nailed this role. Because he's even more nerdy and annoying, but also like charming in the book, if you can imagine. And he was just so well cast. And I don't know, he's got this like magnetism. I was like, and he's like all up in Laura Dern's grill. And I was like, just make out with him, Laura Dern.
Imperfections in the skin.
Yeah, I would. I mean, I was like, okay, in the 2023 light, like that's probably not great that he's like all up in her grill. But in 1993, and as watching this movie, I was like, oh, okay.
Yeah, this might have been the beginning of my lifelong obsession with Jeff Goldblum.
Mine was from Earth Girls Are Easy.
Oh my god! I remember watching that movie. You know.
I'm taking it way back in a deep cut.
Well, and then there's also The Fly,
of course.
You know, I only think about, you know, 90s Jeff was like the big chill. You know, he was so incredibly nerdy. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if you remember that movie, but Mary Kay Place is looking for someone to impregnate her. And he's the only one who's like, me, pick me. And she's like, yeah, no.
Yeah, too eager.
Well, he somehow just makes nerdy sexy single time.
It's crazy. I think this might be his hottest movie for me.
Yeah. Although he gets to be the action star in the sequel, like he's more, I mean, like he, so th- with him waving the flare and everything as they both got out of the car, mm-hmm. and why the T-Rex is attacking, he asked Steven Spielberg to actually change that scene because he was supposed to run away like the lawyer did as well. But he asked him to, if he could actually be a little bit more courageous and lead the Tyrannosaurus away. So I think that was the start of him actually kind of being that little action hero. And then he gets to really take it on in the second film, which was nice.
Although I've heard the second film is trash. I haven't seen it as an anti-Jurassic Park thing. I've just heard it's really bad.
It's not a good movie. Julianne Moore was fine, but it's just not a great movie.
I remember very little from that movie. I actually remembered very little from this movie. Fully forgot. I know we're going to talk about him in a second. Fully forgot that Wayne Knight was in this movie. I mean, he's perfectly cast in this role, but I totally forgot. And when he showed up, I was like, oh, Newman.
Don't get cheap on me now, Dodson. So actually, since we've already started talking about Wayne Knight, let's bring him up as Dennis Nedry, the computer programmer / hacker that is building all the systems that are running Jurassic Park, that apparently is doing more work than he has actually felt he's being paid for. So now he is going to steal from the company and ends up kind of sinking the entire park because of it.
I mean, just I love the shaving cream because that's also a detail in the book. And like how it is like a thing that comes. I was like, that's still pretty cool 30 years later. And it actually comes out with shaving cream. I mean, he plays a schlub. Nobody plays a schlub like Wayne Knight plays an annoying, like, talks too much schlub.
Yeah. He basically brought the Newman to this.
annoying, if that's possible.
Agreed. I don't know that I like Dennis Nedry in this movie, though. I think the whole – I mean, look, Jurassic Park, as we are wont to say here on the Rerun Project, is not Ibsen. And
– it's a great book, though.
It does, but it does have a point. And the point is, like, don't fuck around with things that you cannot control. Mm-hmm. And it is – a big warning against narcissism. And the truth is, when you look at this movie, if he didn't have somebody there who was kind of sabotaging the whole thing, they probably would have been fine. You know, there's nothing in the film that really says that, you know, his grandchildren would have been attacked by a T-Rex and a couple of velociraptors had everything not been purposefully shut down. You know, I think the movie would have been a little bit stronger thematically, and I realize I'm completely overthinking this, but this is what happens when you watch a movie for a podcast and you have to talk about it the next day. If it were just kind of human error that totally could have happened. Mm-hmm. You know, the one thing that's kind of – that had nothing to do with Dennis was the fact that they used that frog DNA, and now apparently they're, you know, switching genders. Better call the GOP. The dinosaurs are doing drag. And, you know, and they're able to procreate even though they decided to make them all female. That was something that actually Richard Attenborough did. But other than that, they just made a bad hire. I mean, this whole movie is HR's fault, really.
Yeah. Well, I guess Nedry was the one time where they did spare an expense, because if they had just paid him a little bit more, he probably would not have tried to steal the embryos and sell them to the highest bidder there. And, you know, it's interesting that you say that about the story of, you know, they probably would have been fine without Dennis Nedry sabotaging them, because I think Jurassic World really plays more on the idea of, you know, everything was going fine until Mother Nature hits. Because I think, isn't there like a volcano that like erupts?
I saw the movie. I don't remember anything. I saw all the new movies too.
Yeah.
Sure. I don't actually remember. I mean, it was a delightful, you know, summer popcorn movie. And like the dinosaurs obviously are like that much more cool because, yeah, you know, it's whatever, 25 years later or whatever. So, but yeah, I think it was a volcano. I'm pretty sure it was a volcano. I think.
So it's more like Mother Nature just kind of decides that this is not a great idea, and then all hell breaks loose.
Well, it's not a great idea. Not to put too fine point on a fine point on it, it's a shitty idea from the start. So,
I mean, who wouldn't be charmed by Richard Attenborough showing up, popping their champagne, and talking them into going to a park for the weekend? I mean, I would go. I didn't even know the man.
Oh, that's not what made him go. He said, I will fund your next expedition. And they were like, let's go.
Yeah, they were like, when do we
for
leave?
For 3 years.
It was not any charm on the part of Richard Attenborough. He was fucking annoying until he offered him a big pile of money.
But I did really enjoy Wayne Knight in that role. I thought he was really well cast. Just annoying enough, but also kind of fun enough on screen. Although I wasn't necessarily sad when he bit it, though, at the end with that dinosaur. It was also a cool way to die, with that one dinosaur spitting all the stuff. Like, I have no idea if that dinosaur really does that in real life. Quote unquote real life. We'll never know whether that actually happened or not, but that was a cool addition.
Yeah. In the book, he's like swarmed by like seven of them.
Yeah.
So it's like even more of like, basically like they're just like basically eating his face off. So I think he's
alive too while they're eating
it
too.
He totally is. Yeah.
Okay. And I'm going to say something again. I'm not really serious as I say this, but I do kind of say this with my 2023 goggles on. Between Wayne Knight and the really annoying fat kid at the beginning who was like, you know, he looked like a big turkey. I was like, this movie's a little fat phobic in terms of, it's like, let's cast all the fat people as super annoying. And I just wonder if this movie, I'm not saying that anything wrong, give Wayne Knight his cred. He plays this character really, really well. Give him all these roles. It's totally fine. But in 2023, I wonder if that would have been something that people would have brought up and complained about. And I think it probably would have been.
Well, yeah. I mean, especially I was just thinking about when they do the like pan to his desk and it's like all candy and food wrappers on the floor and like detritus of sodas and stuff. And I was like, yee, okay, we get it. Like, he's a fat slob. You know what I mean? Like, yeah.
Yeah. That was a little overboard, because it was like, it wasn't just on the desk.
No, it was
like
literally
all
around.
Like, it was a protective moat around his desk to stop people from coming over and bugging him.
It's like, okay. All right.
Next up is Bob Peck as Robert Muldoon.
I do love a South African accent.
Yeah. Just kind of there. I think he was perfectly cast for role, but a fairly one-dimensional character. One of the ones that's kind of lacking in this movie.
All they needed is just put a red shirt on him and just, you know.
You're just waiting for him to bite it.
Waiting for him to bite it, right?
Go off screen.
Well, and that's it. I mean, I think that in a post-Game of Thrones world, people are a little bit more accepting of a character you actually love getting killed. Like, that's just, and it's seen as, you know, to me, if they would have done more with this character, and it's probably more about the script than it is about anything about, you know, poor Bob Peck, who did a perfectly lovely job with what he was given. But if he'd been funny, or if he'd been endearing, or if there's something about him that really made you go, oh, we really like him. Then when he died, it would have been like, holy shit, we better get rid of these fucking dinosaurs. Mm-hmm. You know, instead, it was everyone you liked, you know, saw a new day at the end of the movie, and everyone you didn't like and or didn't really care about was killed.
Yeah.
It was a little convenient. 30 years later. And I think, and it's a total 93 convention that I just wonder where, I think we're a little bit more cynical these days. I think we expect
a little,
a little.
I mean, as I said in the book, Hammond bites it, Malcolm bites it, Malcolm dies from his ankle wound. You know, almost all of the secondary characters die. So it definitely was a little bit more unsympathetic. You know, and something that would normally happen when you have a bunch of fucking crazed dinosaurs is that most people are going to fucking die, right? I'm going to die. I'm in Jurassic Park. I'm dead. Oh. Like, I'm not the end.
I'm not outrunning a raptor. No. That's not going to fucking happen.
But that also supports what this book is supposedly about.
Right.
Right. Which is this, you know, narcissism is bad. You know, we shouldn't trust billionaires, etc. You know, the fact that so many people made it out kind of dilutes. I mean, it makes for a more fun popcorn flick, but it does dilute a little bit of what the movie is trying to say. Again, not Ibsen. I get it, but
still.
I mean, I think it, on the whole, Spielberg generally has a hard time going dark. That's not the way that he does things. So let's take AI for an example. You know, an interesting movie that really could have dealt with what happens when we think about technology as a living thing. And instead of taking the story and talking about, you know, when a person adopts a robot as a child, we let the child go on a wondrous Pinocchio adventure. And it's just, it really didn't get into what the dark side of technology can be. This doesn't either. This was a fun summer popcorn film. It lightly talks about the topic of, you know, you can't control tech, you can't control Mother Nature, but it doesn't get into the darkness.
No, and I appreciate what you said, Ben, about, you know, this was the job that he had to do in order to do Schindler's List. You know, so it's like, okay, this is my money grab, right? And so let's make the movie that's going to make a whole lot of money. But, you know, 6 months later, he's got Ralph Fiennes, you know, on a balcony in Schindler's List, just popping off people one by one because he feels like it. And of course, that infamous little girl in the red dress, the only color in a black and white movie, when you see that little red dress packed onto the wagon with all the other bodies, you can't say that Spielberg is unable to go dark because, wow, he went to the Holocaust. But, you know, not in this movie. And it's fine. And I mean, you know, I'm not mad at the movie. It really is just a comment on 30 years ago, this was like, oh, that was really fun. Now I look at it and I'm like, you know, somebody else should have died. Like somebody halfway through the movie, at kind of the, you know, the low point of the movie should have been somebody that you really cared about, or somebody that another character in this thing really cared about gets eaten. And suddenly it's like, oh, shit. And I think you still could have had your popcorn action adventure fun and had some of the characters fly away in a helicopter at the end, but not the happy little surrogate family.
So you're going to hate me then? If I were going to do that, I would have killed off Ellie Statler.
Oh, totally.
That way at the end, you know, you make this whole, you know, family propaganda thing more meaningful to him, because now he's wondering, you know, if we had had children, I would have had a child with her, blah, blah, you know what I mean? It makes that interaction a little bit more intense, and it causes more question for Dr. Grant.
Yeah, I think she would have been a good choice to, you know, either Ellie or him. You know, Dr. Mm-hmm. Grant himself could have bitten it. And that would have been much more like Game of Thrones. Holy shit, you just killed off your lead, right? You know, and then everyone else has to rally, kind of a thing. Yeah, you know, and then let Ellie like save the kids and save the day while grieving her, you know,
hot boyfriend.
And then Dr. Ian Malcolm can now, you know, console her. I mean, maybe that is the way that we should have
gone. Well, Goldblum and Nintendo had to survive because they were the only greedy whores who were willing to do the sequel. So,
I mean, I'd be laughing all the way to the bank. It still made a shit ton of money.
It did.
Paid for his beach house, paid for his second home.
Fifth Element was a better movie that year, though. Moving on in the cast list, we do have Samuel L. Jackson as Ray Arnold. He didn't get to be the Samuel L. Jackson that we know today. He was just a chain smoking character. Yeah.
I don't want these motherfucking dinosaurs in this motherfucking resort.
Thank you. Yes. Oh man, that would have been awesome. He should have replaced. We could have had him play Robert Muldoon. That would have been better.
Yeah.
Oh my God, that would have been
a cigarette
better.
And like an AK-47.
I mean, could we really smoke indoors in '93? That's the only thing I kept watching.
Yes. Oh, yeah.
He's just chain smoking in
he
that
He sure
office.
Is. He sure is.
They better have some good AC in there. That's all I got to say.
They have very high ceilings.
We have to talk about the kids because this movie does focus on children. Joseph Mazzello as Tim Murphy.
I read a book about dinosaurs and it was bigger than the book.
So Tim is better in the book, but Lex is actually worse, if you can imagine that.
Lex played by Ariana Richards.
I prefer to be called a hacker.
I mean, it's the dialogue she's given. It's not her fault.
No, but as soon as she mentioned she was good with computers, and I was like, and let me guess, Steven, at some point she's going to sit down in front of a computer and save the day because that's her talent that you've already kind of placed in the, you know, it's the same way when Sam Neill was describing exactly how a velociraptor eats you at the beginning to the annoying turkey kid. I'm like, this will come in handy later. You know, I mean, it's just, it's fine. And it, you know, it's, again, it's entertaining, but it was one of those things that it's so easily telegraphed. Yeah. Now, you know, when you get, even the stupid little, you know, film reel that we watched at the beginning and we replaced the DNA with a frog. I'm like, I bet that will be important later on.
They have to place those little nuggets so you can go back to them later. I mean, yeah, they definitely laid some breadcrumbs up for us as we were going through this film.
But you know, the breadcrumb that was really well laid is when the very beginning of the movie, when you saw the mosquito in amber. Mm-hmm. I put the whole thing together right away. I'm like, holy shit, they took dinosaur blood out of the mosquito and that's how they got the DNA. Like, I did all that myself. So audiences are smart, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, if you give them enough stuff, they will pick up a lot. And that's the reason that the frog thing stood out. I'm like, I knew all this from the amber. The only new piece of information was the frog. So that's going to show up at some point. And sure enough, life finds a way.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I still do love this movie. I think
I do. I mean, it's very, very entertaining, but it's just interesting how all these conventions. And when you watch a movie again, if I had just watched Jurassic Park to watch Jurassic Park and not watched it so I could discuss it with my colleague on a podcast the next day, I wouldn't have noticed half this shit. I would have just sat there with my popcorn and beer and watched a really fun movie.
And since we were talking about the science, one last person on the cast list, B.D. Wong as Dr. Henry Wu.
Never can do any wrong. No. B.D. Wong for life. B.D. Wong for president. Whatever. Yeah. Love him.
Yeah. I always see him in bit roles like this, though. I mean, because he was only in the first, like, maybe third of the film. And then once the storm hits, he gets off the island. I would have enjoyed him being there more. But he has popped up in the universe in a couple of other places in this film.
Well, I mean, you got to watch Law & Order SVU. I mean, he's like a main character on that.
Is he really?
Oh my God, yeah. He is one of the, he's like the main FBI psychiatrist.
And he will always be the priest on Oz for me.
Oh, I've never watched Oz.
Oh, you need to see Chris Maloney in the shower in Oz. Oh. You like Law & Order SVU, you get to see all of Chris Maloney in Oz. Just
the
saying.
Whole Maloney. Some beefy, beefy Maloney. B.D. Wong for me, I always remember Father of the Bride.
Yeah,
he's the assistant. He's with Martin Short's assistant.
That was my first B.D. Wong introduction.
And of course, his name is B.D. Wong because he rose to prominence in M. Butterfly, and his stage name had to be something that would shock people when they realized that he was a man in the middle of Act Two.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Have you ever seen M. Butterfly?
No.
I mean, I knew the story, but no.
Yeah, they made a movie out of it, and B.D. Wong was not in the movie, which is really sad. But yeah, this whole thing is, you know, this Asian woman is seducing an American, or not an American, he's European, I think, a white diplomat. And halfway through the movie, the character disrobes and hello, that's not a girl.
It's the crying game.
And it's a moment. It's a very crying game kind of thing. In fact, I think the play was before that. That's an interesting question. I don't know which came first. But yes, BD Wong was a sensation in this movie because all throughout Act One, audiences were like, who's this lovely woman playing Song Liling? You know, and it's, oh, it's an actress named BD Wong. And it's like, that's not an actress. His big kind of starring. That's what put him out there.
Oh, that's interesting to know. I didn't know that. The more you know.
That's not a pillow. I hope we talk about that movie on here.
I need to go back and rewatch that.
You know, back in the Pop-A-Ration days, we did a thing called Thanksgiving at the Movies, and Planes, Trains, and Automobiles was the first thing that we discussed.
R.I.P. John Candy. I mean, honestly.
So I'm going to ask the obvious, which did you prefer, the book or movie?
I actually reread this right before we were recording this because I hadn't written it in a while. Wow. Because I hadn't read it in a while. So it's still really good. There was a lot of science in it. I don't remember that much science. But as I said in my Goodreads review, all of the dinosaur parts in the book are fucking awesome. So it sort of counterbalances like the too much science, what I thought. Like there were definitely pages of dialogue from Ian Malcolm that I was like, nope, not interested in this. Like, yeah. But the book is really excellent. And, you know, as I said before, it's darker. In the sense that like lots of people die and everybody is really like hanging by a string, you know, at the end of a movie. And it's not quite as heartwarming, which I prefer because I have a lot of darkness inside of me apparently. And so I like things when things are darker, not visually. HBO, do you hear me? Like put some lights in your fucking shows because I can barely see anything.
Not everybody has a $3,000 TV at home.
I mean, I can't. Even The Last of Us, shit. Like it was bad in Game of Thrones, obviously, because everybody talks about it. But even The Last of Us, like thank God I put the closed caption on because like there were scenes where I was like, what? What's going on? But Michael Crichton is a spectacular author and I would encourage everyone to read all of his books. You could skip Timeline. And Congo is just okay. But like the rest of his stuff is, he was a legit genius, RIP. He was a legit genius. And like, you can just, but he had like, it was like, he was a genius because like all the science shit, but like also could write a compelling story. It's a really interesting combination, I think.
Congo was a better book than it was a movie. This one for me, I saw the movie first and then I realized it was a book. So I went and read the book afterwards. And I think I like them equally separately because I feel the story is different enough from like all the stuff that you talked about that it's a different kind of vibe for both of those mediums. Mm-hmm. So I enjoy them both equally separately, which is kind of weird. Most of the time, I prefer either the book or the movie. This time, I was totally fine.
Yeah, I think both of them are good interpretations for sure.
Yeah.
This is the kind of thing where I saw this movie and for whatever reason, and I probably won't read the book and I understand that it's genius and, you know, I'm missing out, but that's okay because I don't read very fast and so I'm very picky. I read. But I saw this movie and I'm like, I really don't need to read the book. I just saw a dinosaur eat a lawyer sitting on a toilet. Like, what is a
book? It's like the pinnacle, right?
That and shake him around like a dog with a rag toy. I mean, it just, that's what I needed from Jurassic Park. And the movie was just, it gave it to me. And I just kind of thought, I don't need to read the book. And yet I'm really happy to hear that the book is a little bit darker because there's the one thing when I watched this movie 30 years later. And when I saw it 30 years ago, I saw it in the theater. I think I saw it twice or three times in the theater. Because it was amazing and I wasn't picking up on all this other kind of stuff because my life was ahead of me and so I wasn't on so much of a being child free is a valid choice back then. But it gave me everything I possibly could have needed. And so, you know, will I read the book? No. I mean, I saw the movie and it took me 2 hours and it was amazing and I saw real live dinosaurs. So there I am.
Well, and I bet you the original script treatment was darker because Michael Crichton did the original strip. He did the original script treatment from the book. They bought that from him. And then they had David co-op? Did we figure out
how to pronounce
this? No.
DK.
DK. We had DK come back in and modify the script afterwards. So I have a feeling they probably lightened it up.
I'm sure.
And you know, we might have not, they might have killed off original characters. Maybe he kept it closer to the script. Although I have a feeling they were also thinking franchise. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, if we want to keep some of our main characters for that next film.
No, this was definitely, they knew what they were doing when they made this movie. This was designed to make a shit ton of money, and it did.
Yeah.
Which is fine.
I'm not mad at it. Like, yeah. No,
I was happy to give them my money to go see that movie.
Yeah. This movie was not marketed, you know, for your consideration. You know, that's not what this, and yet it did win some Oscars, you know, but it wasn't marketed to be that movie. This was a summer popcorn blockbuster, and it scored. You know, it's just 30 years later, let's watch it for a discussion. I'm like, okay. Then I'm like looking at it in a very different way, and I'm like, You can not have kids.
It's interesting the questions that are coming up, but this is not what I thought we would be talking about.
Glad we're throwing you for a loop today, Matt.
So what I thought we would discuss would be, so why didn't you start with condors? What the fuck?
You're not making money. Bird. Yeah, you're not making money with condors. He's a billionaire. He's putting in, you know, $1 trillion into, you know, getting, you know, buying amber mines to get fucking mosquito DNA, the dinosaur blood out of mosquitoes. So he, you know, he needs a little rate of return.
I guess, but wouldn't you test the technology? I mean, hopefully they did somewhere else before just deciding, you know what, let's just go full bore here. Let's just build some dinosaurs.
See, I don't know if this was even discussed in the movie. If it was, I missed it. I was under the impression that this little operation had been around for something like 20 years and they were perfecting and doing this. And he was just continually pouring more money into it. And now, only now that they're about to open, because they're going to make money with all of their T-Rexes and velociraptors, that now he needs to get it inspected and blah, 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 blah. I mean, I assumed this was a long process going forward. By the way, though, I did love the fact that the lawyer who was like so against it, all of a sudden he gets there. And I'm like, this is going to make us so rich. Yes. The answer is yes. And I'm like, you know, I know some lawyers, they're not evil, but that was funny. I laughed. That was a nice touch.
Well, and he's representing the investors, and they're in, like, now he understands like how much money this park actually will make, and that their investment, you know, is probably could have been a safe investment. I mean, again, fucking raptors. If it had just been the T-Rex, they probably would have been fine. If they hadn't have bred raptors, that's where it really all went downhill.
Well, several things here. First of all, in the book, yes, the Jurassic Park, Isla Nublar, Island of the Clouds, is not around for a while, but InGen, the company that Hammond runs, has been around for a while. And he sort of alludes to a park in Kenya. And you wonder if that was maybe like a little bit of a test case, but in the
tiny elephant, right?
Something like that. Yes. And like, they talk about like developing this stuff for years and years, but like Jurassic Park itself or that island, maybe like 7 or 8. I feel like this was also like put out at a time where people were like, clones there. That's crazy. Like, don't touch my DNA. So I feel like there was like some of that in the mix too.
Dolly was born in 96.
So 2 years.
So it was just
3 years after that.
3 years before Dolly.
So we were talking about cloning at the time. And I mean, it's cloning technology. It's interesting. I still think that bringing back extinct animals, even, you know, I that was one conversation that I disagreed with Malcolm on. The whole idea of chaos and everything is correct, but I don't think Mother Nature selects anything for extinction. I mean, we tend to think of Mother Nature as an actual entity with reason, and it's not. It is just kind of random events that happen, and then either a species is equipped to deal with the effects of those events, or it's not equipped to deal with the effects of the events. Dinosaurs became extinct because of the event that happened, you know, with the asteroid and everything changing the environment and stuff. And they kind of, then they died out because of those quick rapid changes. At least my limited remembrance of like all that stuff from school. That was the one part of the movie that I disagree with.
I do agree with the whole life will find a way, though, thing. I mean, that's mm-hmm. what evolution is, right? It's that, yes. you know, you if it's possible to evolve your way around a problem, we will do it. And human nature is absolutely designed to do that. Hence, you have frogs who can turn themselves into males and mm-hmm. continue to procreate if necessary. Yeah. And that's just an example of, you know, we will, you know, so life will fight for itself.
Yes.
And that will always be true. And I think that piece was right on.
So this movie, too, was kind of inspired for Spielberg by Godzilla films, which are actually a cautionary tale, too, on nuclear power usage. So an explosion and bomb, nuclear bombs and things like that. So it's interesting that there are parallels in this movie and the technology, and he's drawing inspiration for, you know, the T-Rex and a lot of that from those movies as well.
I mean, Isla Nublar needed a nuclear power plant. Just add that in there.
It kind of reminded me of King Kong a little bit, only not that we created King Kong, but this whole thing, you know, you see this giant ape that's the size of, like, you know, a four-story building, and you're like, let's bring it to New York. What could go wrong? You know, it's just people are stupid when it comes to a lot of this shit.
So you guys ready for some fun facts?
Always.
Boop.
So studios started bidding on this book before it was actually published.
Not surprising.
Yeah. Spielberg learned about it when he was working with Crichton on ER. Like, they were putting together the treatment for that. And he was fascinated with the idea. Universal paid $1.5 million for the story rights with Spielberg attached. They beat out Warner Brothers, who is using Tim Burton.
A Tim Burton Jurassic Park. Let's just pause there for a moment.
It'd be darker. It'd have been darker.
It would have been darker, but it might also have been Planet of the Apes. Yeah. And we just did not need that. Columbia Pictures and Richard Donner, which I think could have been darker too. I would have actually been interested. Some other people that were up for casting, I thought this was interesting. William Hurt and Harrison Ford were offered the role of Grant before Sam Neill was.
I think William Hurt would have been a good Dr. Grant. I'm whatever Harrison Ford, but like William Hurt is intriguing to me.
Well, I kind of feel like Dr. Grant was a little bit too similar to Indiana Jones, and people would have just like gone into this movie thinking it was some kind of sequel. So
yeah, I mean, when it starts off with an archaeological dig, you know, I mean, it kind of would have been cool if this were, you know, a period piece. If Indiana Jones could have like gone to Jurassic Park, that could have been like, you know,
Indiana Jones
and the Island of Dinosaurs. You know, yeah,
well, movie number seven.
Of course, William Hurt, we now know, is a trash human. So I mean, R.I.P. But you know. Gross. So, you know, but yes, he, as an actor, I think he would have, he would have been a very soulful mm-hmm. Dr. Grant.
Sensitive.
Yeah. Spielberg chose Wayne Knight based on his performance in Basic Instinct.
Of course.
I love Basic Instinct.
I don't think I've ever seen that
movie. I think it's a good movie.
Okay. I think they're making a, they're remaking it or turning it into a TV series.
That's right, not necessary, but okay.
Yeah.
They're turning Fatal Attraction into a TV series. Is that what you're thinking of?
I think I'm thinking Fatal Attraction.
Also not necessary, but okay.
Well, although, have you heard of the let's take a little Fatal Attraction detour since we did talk about this last year. The TV show actually takes place years from now. So Fatal Attraction actually did happen in the 80s, but it was the ending Glenn Close wanted. And Alex Forrest framed that guy for murder, and he's been sitting in jail for 30 years.
Oh.
And that's the new Fatal Attraction. Okay. So
I'm semi-intrigued.
Interesting. I mean, they're playing with it. They're not just doing like, oh, let's turn this movie into a TV show for the cheap cash. I mean, they are kind of, you know, making a statement, if you will.
Fatal Attraction Requiem. Yeah. Ariana Richards learned after she had been cast that she was chosen because of her scream. Apparently, all the actresses for that role had to go and do a scream test, and they recorded it. Spielberg was at home going through all of the screen tests, and hers was the only one to wake up his sleeping wife. She came like running into the room, like, are the kids okay? And so that's why she was actually chosen for the role.
I mean, as good a reason as any, right?
Seriously. Oh, and her scream was really good. I learned the other day that I don't know how to scream. We were supposed to be doing it for something, and it was for the Indiana Jones stunt spectacular in Hollywood Studios, and they get the audience to scream, and I didn't know how to scream. I realized that I can yell, I can't scream. So
I'm a good screamer. Shocking to no one, I'm sure.
And then lastly, Samuel L. Jackson's character was originally going to be chased and killed by raptors, so he was going to have a nice gory end. But they were filming in Hawaii, and a hurricane destroyed the set that they were going to be using.
See, nature. So nature's like, don't fuck with me.
But you know what? In 2023, if he got a real gory death scene, everyone would be like, he's the only black character in this whole thing. That's racist. Not saying they'd be wrong, but I mean, it's one of those things that's like, you know, oh, all the nice white people survived. How-
wah, wah, wah.
So are you guys ready for a game?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. So this game is called Hit the Books.
It's a good game for me.
So pick a book to convert into a movie or series, cast it, and who directs. And I'm going to choose Allie to go first.
Okay. So, you know, I'm a big nerdy reader. I had a lot of books to choose from in my mind. But I wanted to do a book that has not been done and should be done, and is my favorite book, second only probably to A Tree Grows in Brooklyn, if you know about my history with that. So I am choosing to make The Historian by Elizabeth Kostova, an Apple TV miniseries. I don't want to tell you a lot about this book, because if you read it, and you should read it, friend of the pod, Joe, it's probably one of the few times that we disagreed about a book. It's one of my favorites. He didn't really like it very much. So he's probably listening to this right now and rolling his eyes, but it's going to happen, and it really needs to be made into a story. But basically, y'all should read it, but it's a twist on Dracula, but it deals with a real person, Vlad the Impaler. And it's basically about, it's a scary AF book. Like, I love a scary book. This book is scary. And it's sort of about a guy named Paul who works at Oxford, and he finds this mysterious hand-cut book with like a symbol from Vlad. And he meets a woman, and they go on this quest, and things happen. I'm being specifically vague because it's such a good story. So I've cast my top three people. So Paul, he's going to be played by Dan Stevens, who, you know, he hasn't done very much, like not really since Beauty and the Beast. And I think that he has some gravitas, could play a kind of nerdy librarian, is also hot. So covers all the bases. My Helen is going to be, I don't really like her, but I think she's a good actress. My Helen's going to be Anna de Armas. Helen in the book is the daughter of another librarian who dies because of this mysterious kind of curse thing. So, but then Paul and Helen end up getting married, and the narrator of the book is their unnamed 16-year-old daughter. So it's all very mysterious. I didn't cast her. But then as Vlad the Impaler, you know, I feel like he can do this, and he's done it in a jokey way. But Tom Hiddleston is going to be my Vlad, because I feel like he needs a role that's like really meaty, that he could, pardon the pun, sink his teeth into. And I feel like he could go there. And this is going to be directed by Ryan Coogler. And, you know, if you like Dracula, and if you like kind of want to know the history behind it, and if you're a big nerd like I am, and you like kind of darkness and lots of people dying, go read The Historian. It's really fucking good.
Cool. I like it. Actually, and I'm adding that to my list. I think I am going to read that. That sounds like a good
book. It's really good.
Eric, you're up next.
Okay. So as soon as I saw this game, I opened up my Goodreads account. I'm like, okay, what have I read recently? And everything I have read recently is already being made into a movie or a TV series.
Doesn't matter.
I agree. I had to really go deep.
So, I mean, I looked at like Lessons in Chemistry being made on Apple TV Plus right now with Brie Larson. I was like, Daisy Jones and the Six already came out, you know, and it was just like, all right, fine. So I went way, way back. This is a book that I love. This book, I loved it at the time. I should reread it. It's called Three Junes by Julia Glass. It was the National Book Award winner of 2002. And it's not about three women named June. It's about 3 months of June in 1989, 1995, and 1999. So it's very episodic, and it might actually be a better like three-part, you know, limited series on some kind of prestige television network or something for that reason. But in the first June, 1989, it's about a guy who's grieving his wife who goes to Greece. He's Scottish, but he takes a vacation in Greece and meets a young American artist who kind of gets him out of his grieving doldrums. And the whole time I'm reading this, I'm like, ooh, don't get together. She's so young. Ooh. And they don't, but it's actually kind of wholesome. She does kind of, you know, make him laugh and just kind of make him realize that life is still worth living. Not for long though, because in 1995 in Scotland, he's dead and his family comes for the funeral. And you meet his eldest son, who's this gay man named Fenno, who actually lives in New York, where he runs a bookshop in Greenwich Village. So if you're a sucker for a Greenwich Village bookshop setting, the way I am, you know, right away, love this guy. And he's kind of, you know, dealing with the whole grieving thing. And then in June 1999, we're back in New York, and Fenno meets Fern, this young American artist who met his father 10 years before, and they have kind of an interaction, and he learns more about his dad. It's a very interior kind of book. And so it's one of those things that it doesn't lend itself to. It's like, ooh, let's make a movie. So I had Stephen Daldry tapped to direct it because he did The Hours. And I thought, when I read The Hours, I thought this is unfilmable. And I thought that what he did to make that movie was actually quite lovely. And it really worked for me. So I thought if anyone could do it, he could do it. I cast David Tennant to play Paul, the grieving husband of the very first episode, if you will. Michelle Williams, who, as you know, I think can do no wrong, as Fern, the young American artist. So that if anyone's going to get you out of grief, you know, it would be lovely, plucky Michelle Williams. And then Fenno, I had to look. I'm like, who is a Scottish actor who can do this? And y'all, did y'all see It's a Sin on HBO Max, that British TV series that went back and looked at the AIDS crisis in the UK? David Carlyle played a role in that, and he was so good. And his scene where he first kind of admits that he's HIV positive, but they clearly don't know anything about the disease yet, and he feels better today, so he wonders if he's just getting better. And you're watching this thing going, oh, honey, no, you're not getting any better, you know, but he doesn't know that. And so he's like thrilled that he might. Anyway, breaks your heart. And he would be great. When I first read this, Fenno was absolutely Alan Cumming and Fern was absolutely Gwyneth Paltrow. They were like in my head as I was reading the book, but they're way too old for these roles now. So I had to go back to the mat for that one. But anyway, Three Junes will probably never be made into a movie. But if it were, that's who I'd cast.
Nice. That actually sounds very interesting.
I know. I was like, I've never heard of this. Maybe I'll go read the book.
Yeah.
Very quiet, okay. Very interior, but it's a lovely read. I enjoyed it.
So I sadly have now picked a movie that I wish I hadn't checked. That is a book that is actually already being turned into a movie, and I do not like their casting. So I'm happy with my
fighting
casting.
Words.
So I'm in a sci-fi book club. The last book we read is actually probably one of the best books we have read. So I'm going to turn Project Hail Mary by Andy Weir.
I love that book. I really enjoyed that book. I've read all of his books, and I was really shocked at how much I liked it. I didn't know they were making it into a movie. God.
Yeah, they're making it into a movie. They're casting. Well, so before I get into the casting, I think this book has to be a miniseries to actually do the book justice. It can't just be a movie. I think you'd cut too much out and you wouldn't appreciate everything that happens if you do that. So like a 4-part series would be great.
This is true for all books as far as I'm concerned, by the way. Turn short stories into feature films, make books into prestige miniseries. You can do that.
So this story, basically they realize that something is happening to our sun. It is losing output, essentially. So they start to figure out what it is, and then they have to the world actually comes together because we are about to go into a nuclear winter, or not a nuclear winter, but just a solar winter, I guess. We are gonna starve because we don't have enough solar energy to actually produce food. Might you
say winter is coming?
Winter is coming. Fortunately, there's no dragons. So we have to get together, and the Earth kind of comes together on this because otherwise we are going to all die. And so they create a space program because they discover that this is happening to other stars. And so they find a star that it is not happening to. So they decide to go to that star to figure out what is going on, essentially. So there's all of this, you know, science going on explaining this. And as the story unfolds, we are already at the star, and the character wakes up with amnesia, trying to push this back, put it back together. So he is remembering things. So you're going back and forth as the story unfolds. It was really well written. And then as we get there, other things start to happen. We meet an alien species at that point. I don't want to give too much away because it is a fantastic book.
It's really good.
So the main character is Ryland Grace. He is was a renowned scientist that left the academic field because he kind of got his feelings hurt. And so he became a middle school science teacher, and he's found happiness in doing that. He's kind of he's kind of a schlub of a guy. I mean, and then ends up finding himself halfway across the universe, you know, at the star. I actually cast Pedro Pascal. He has to be a very likable human guy. You know, Pedro Pascal is attractive, but not overly attractive. He just seems like somebody you would sit down and have a beer with. I mean, that's the kind of person I want in this role. They cast Ryan Gosling.
Oh, no.
No. Wrong person for this role. The other major character in the book is Eva Straat, who is the Dutch, organizer. So the UN gave her all of the power that she needs to make this entire mission happen. And she makes it all happen. She can do whatever she wants. I have actually Tilda Swinton as cast as her in the book. So I listened to the audiobook. The guy that reads the audiobook is great. When he voices Eva Straat, it sounds a little bit like, or at least to me, what's her name from The Incredibles?
Edna Mode.
Edna Mode. So it's kind of the character that I have in my mind. And I think Tilda Swinton, though, would be amazing. We also have two more astronauts. Yao Li Ji, who is from China. I have Andrew Koji playing him. So if you ever watched The Warriors, which was on HBO, but it didn't start there. I think it started on another channel. It might have been AMC. Great show. Love that show. It's basically about Chinese gangs in San Francisco around the turn of the century when we're building the railroads.
Oh, I'm interested in that.
Really good. Very good
the
show.
The Warriors? Is that what?
The Warriors. Okay, it's called Warrior. Just Warrior.
I'm very fascinated by that time of history.
Yeah, it was a great series. Really enjoyed it. I think there's a third season too coming out that I haven't seen yet. And then lastly, we have Olesya Ilyunka, who is the Russian astronaut, or I guess would be a cosmonaut. If you have ever watched The Expanse on Sci-Fi, great TV series, she plays Drummer. I am having this character was played by Sarah Gee. She is a Canadian actress. She is fantastic. I think she'd be wonderful in this role. And then the whole thing, I want Guillermo del Toro to actually direct this because it has to be dark but human. I mean, all of his movies kind of deal with weird creatures too, which we're going to get to inside the story, but humanizing them. And I think he would be fantastic at doing that. So I would really have it directed by Guillermo del Toro. I would love to see this. This is like, I would be super excited. I'm not so excited. I mean, Ryan Gosling is a good actor. He's just ill cast for this role.
You know, maybe he can do schlubby better than we know. I mean, you know.
I'm looking at a set photo now, and no, he is all American. Not quite Ken.
Okay.
But yeah, he is not schlubby at all.
His Ken looks hysterical though. So I'm gonna stand for Ryan Gosling as Ken.
Oh, I'm gonna be there opening weekend, and I saw something that said that he wanted to do this movie, and he said that it was the best script he's ever read.
Yeah. And Greta Gerwig, I trust her. I absolutely trust her with this kind of, absolutely.
I'm ready.
I think it's going to be so much fun.
So, and in case anybody's not sure what we're talking about the Barbie. So
I'm going to beat you off. I'll beat you both off. No one's beating anybody off.
Oh, goodness. So last part of our show is skip rent or buy. Skip, AI tales are more interesting. Rent, I mean, the trip is paid for. I guess I'll see what's on your island. And buy, spare no expense. I want a pet T-Rex. So let's reverse the role. Let's reverse the roles. Wait a minute, who did I have go first? Allie. So Eric, you go first.
I have to say, I'm a rent on Jurassic Park. Hadn't seen it for 30 years. Saw it 3 times in the theater when it came out. You know, 30 years ago, I was all about it. Watched it again this week, and I enjoyed it. And I'm good. So, you know, and I think that not every movie, again, not Ibsen, not every movie has to be, you know, watched multiple times in order for you to call it a good movie. But I'm good with Jurassic Park. Yeah, solid rent for me.
Allie?
Yeah, same. Watched in the movie theater. Read the book. Always read the book. Saw it again. Was entertained. And I'm good. I'm good. I don't probably, you know, if, again, if somebody was like, hey, I've never seen Jurassic Park, I'd be like, great, let's go watch it. But yeah, I think everybody needs to see it because I do think it is a top of that kind of genre and was really groundbreaking for the time. And, you know, the story is good and entertaining. So yeah, solid rent.
And I am going to step it up and say a buy. I think this is a wonderful formula for that summer blockbuster. I think it really kind of brought back our summer blockbusters in a sense. I love this movie. It is comfort food for me. I mean, it is just, I sit down at any time it would be on, I would just sit down and watch it. So I kind of wish the rest of them weren't made and we just stood alone, kind of like The Matrix. We didn't need the rest of them. We just needed the first movie. I'm going to say that the rest of them are fine. I would not sit down and rewatch them. This one I would rather rewatch instead of any of those additional films. So there you go. Two rents and a buy.
Pretty good. Two rents and a buy is high praise for us.
I think so. We've been all over the place lately. So next up is going to be that 1988 classic Working Girl.
Gosh, I'm ready. I can't wait.
I've never seen this movie. So I will be watching.
It's excellent.
Your hotness correspondent is very excited.
It is Harrison Ford's hottest movie, bar none. I'm going on record saying that. I will say that in the episode too. Done.
Interesting. Good. Mm-hmm. Good reason to watch the movie. Mm-hmm. Once again, this has been the Rewind Project. Thanks for joining us. I'm Matt.
I'm Allie.
I'm Eric.
Be kind. Rewind.
You've been listening to The Rewind Project. You can find us wherever you get your podcasts, including Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Radio Public, and Google Play. Please subscribe and rate us. It helps a lot. We love your comments and questions. You can find us on Facebook, Twitter, and via our new phone number, 202-618-2402. Thanks for listening. Be kind. Rewind.
So let's get right off of, actually, I should kind of rephrase that statement. Let's start this right now.